In this video, I want to talk about a common myth in software development, which is coding is the toughest part. And you heard it so many times that coding is very hard. Even myself, back in the days, starting out my career, I used to think that coding was very hard. I used to see so many lines of code. Sometimes I would even go to interviews and events and I'd ask people, how many lines of code do you write daily? And that's because I was just too scared in terms of writing code. I used to think that coding was very difficult, up to a point where I realized, you know what, coding is the easiest part. If you're new to my channel, literally just take 1 second and smash the like button. Also, if you haven't subscribed, do so, because this helps a lot in terms of us growing the channel and providing you with better content. First, let me actually clarify that coding, yes, it's important and crucial when it comes to build software. And it's one that you should never neglect. In order for you to be comfortable in terms of writing code, you need to understand the foundations, the basics of a programming language, and be aware that coding is just a tool. Don't be someone that will always say, oh, I only work with this language, or I only work with that language, because what you should be thinking about is how to solve problems. So you should be an engineer that is ready to solve problems. And coding itself, it's a skill that you can master it over time. And it's not that you're going to master coding from the first month or 3 months or 6 months. Think of it as a marathon, okay? So the more you do it, the more you practice, the more you become good at it. So coding, yes, it's important and vital, but it's not the most important thing. And also, luckily for you, you have YouTube, ChatGPT these days, you've got Stack Overflow, you've got GitHub, and you have content creators that make the process of learning coding so easy. So you could just watch through learning. And in my early days, this is how I've learned how to code. So I was never someone that was into books, but rather I would watch and then practice. And then over time, it just became natural. If I wanted to do something, it was just like natural. Is like you learning, for example, how to speak Spanish or Arabic. In the beginning, it's going to be difficult, but the more you do it, the more you practice, you can actually start to have conversation. And it's the same thing with coding. So let's actually break down step by step all the things which, when you build software, they can be actually quite challenging and probably you're not aware of. And in this video, I want to make sure that you think about the bigger picture. So number one is designing a system. So when you build application, there's many things that you have to factor in. Does your system works across multiple servers or just a single server? How do you handle load? How do you make sure that you can handle concurrent requests? How do you make sure that, for example, you can cope with failures? Do you connect to one database? Do you connect to two databases? Do you split your application from a monolithic to a microservice application? How do you perform deployments? How do you make sure that your CI pipeline is quick enough to allow you to be more productive? How do you onboard newcomers coming into the system? Do you have the right documentation and tooling around it? So designing an application is not something which is trivial. And in fact, if you are applying for many companies, Google, Meta, Microsoft, and all of these tech giants, and including startups as well, you need to know how to design system. Do you have a load balancer, caching? How do you auto scale and all of that good stuff, right? So it's very important and one that you should pay attention. Okay, so that is system design, and it's a big topic, and there's many people out there giving you awesome resources in terms of system design. Now, as you build a system, you have system design and you've got an idea of how to implement it, then how are you going to project manage the development? So it's very easy when it's just you working and you're building a small application. But now if you have, let's say, 1,000 developers working, how do you project manage that? And I can tell you, it's very, very painful, right? One that we software engineers, we overlook and we say, oh, look at this project manager. It just comes to the meetings and X, Y, Z, and it doesn't know what he's talking about. But they also have a difficult job. And, you know, if you are a software engineer, part of it is managing also a small team, right? So you've got you know, the project manager, then you've got the engineering lead, for example, that is overseeing everyone. And then within the engineering teams, you have sub teams that also have to be micromanaged. So project management is something that shouldn't be taken for granted. With this comes communication skills. So I've worked within teams where communication wasn't really there. So I remember back in the days, I used to work with a remote team in China, and communication was just through, I think back in the days, it was Microsoft. I can't remember the exact app name. It wasn't Slack back in the days, but it was something to do with Microsoft. And the guys from China, they wouldn't speak if I tried to communicate with them. It was only via text, and I found it really difficult to work like that. So, you know, the code base didn't have no tests, and I wanted to basically find out what is the reason. I wanted to improve things, but communication wasn't there. And sometimes we just think that we know everything. And if someone says, look, I think we can improve this part of the application in a certain manner, sometimes we might take that a bit offensive, but you shouldn't, okay? You should always take the comments and the opinions in a good way, because part of building software is that, you know, people come from different backgrounds and different ideas, different angles, different views, and that's how you build good software. Your code will never last forever, right? So don't think that just because you wrote one class, that class will not be modified in the future. And in fact, it will not be the same. Next, moving on to debugging. So this is important. So sometimes we write a system and it works locally on our machine, which is absolutely fine. And probably you heard this, it works on my machine, but it doesn't work on production or on your machine or somewhere else. And that's because whatever you wrote is missing a few things. And part of the process sometimes is making sure that you know how to debug your code in production or whatever environment. So if things go wrong, then you have all the tooling around. So if you deploy an application to production and you have a bunch of 500s, right? So internal server errors, and you have no logging, how do you debug that, right? So you need to make sure you have the debugging tools around it, the monitoring tools, so that if anything happens, then you can basically debug. So usually this is part of the DevOps team where they have all the Grafana, Prometheus, all the monitoring boards, alerting and all that stuff to make sure that if anything goes wrong, then you have the tools necessary to act quickly. So this is very important. And the last thing that I want to talk to you is that technology moves at a very fast pace. So this piece of technology that you've worked today, in about a month, 2, 3, or next year, it might be completely different and you're going to have to readapt, right? Now, just imagine, so if we take a look, for example, Android. So when Android switched from Java to Kotlin, a lot of these Android houses, they had to switch to Kotlin. Now, in order for you to switch language, it's not just like that, right? So you need to learn the language, you need to understand the intents of the language. And that was, you know, for many teams, a difficult process, right? So how do you adapt? How do you teach? How do you make sure that you follow the right patterns for that particular language? So making sure that you keep up to date with the latest trends, the latest technology, and be ready to change. So if your application is working beautifully with a particular language and you actually reach a bottleneck, if you have to make changes to improve the system and those changes might seem big, then trust me, this is something that a lot of teams actually work, for example, migration projects, migrating from A to X, cloud providers, infrastructure as code, and there's a bunch of things that you should be worrying about instead of just thinking about, oh, coding is the hardest thing. Now, next time that you think that coding is the hardest thing, please stop, because coding, in my opinion, is the easiest one amongst all of them. As I said, you can find literally these days, like you've got frameworks, you've got Stack Overflow, you've got ChatGPT, And if you want to implement something, it's not like you're going to start from scratch. And you've seen most of the times when you were applying for jobs and these tech challenges, you'll see binary trees and all these different data structures. Let me tell you that most of the times you don't use none of that, like literally none of that, right? So you should be an engineer. So be ready to be an engineer that is able to solve problems and stop thinking about the language, coding, because it's the easiest bit. Cool. This is pretty much what I wanted to say. Let me know whether you agree or disagree. Comment down below, smash the like button, and I'll catch you on the next one. Assalamu alaikum.